Hi everyone, welcome to another session of PMF Connect. My name is Julia. I work as a head of product for Product Management Festival. Thank you so much for joining us today. As usual, I'm gonna bore you with a bit of details about what the PMF is doing. Maybe some of the things are new to you, so hopefully brings you some benefits. We have different initiatives, so I'm just going to share pick my screen with some details. As PMF, we organize different activities. So one of them is are the conferences, one in which is taking place in Switzerland, one is taking place in Singapore. These are big events. Right now, we are still planning to do the one in November in Zurich, most probably with less people than usual, but still in person, and hopefully it will be a great event. And for everyone else who cannot attend, we're doing a lot of events online. So PMF Connects are just one of the series of events which we are doing. We're also organizing PM Nights. These are more for local communities taking place online. We announce them through our newsletters. For the people who are more senior, we are organizing as well small circles for product leaders to discuss their challenges at this moment. These are not super obvious right now, so there's not a central point where you can find them, but if you're interested in the information, because it's an invitation only event, and it's just for people who are at a certain seniority, just you can write us and we can let you know where is this happening in your location, or if it's not happening in your location, we're always eager to build new communities. And another activity we have is the PMEP. Basically, education for product leaders, either for aspiring product leaders. So if you're looking to get in a role where you're managing product teams, this is a great program for you. Or if you are in a new role in the whole management of product teams is a bit challenging, this course can help you a lot. So it's a 1 week, takes place on the INSEAD campus in Paris. Five product leaders from different companies are coming to teach you different come to lecture on different topics. We're running this since 2 years and we've had great feedback, so actually people are advancing after doing the program. And if you want to take out your phone to scan, we also offer the Product Management Trends and Benchmarks report for free. So you can see it here. You can scan the QR code and automatically download this report. It's over 70 graphs about from salaries to psychological safety, tools you can use as a product manager, and many, many other information which is can help you in your role, either for you personally as a product manager or for you building products or for you leading a team. So there's really everything in there. And we're sharing this absolutely for free. Every year we're doing it. The only thing we always need from the community is to help us with answers. So next year when we send out the survey, please answer basically the power is in each of you to share your knowledge, and we on our side, we are trying to process the information and share it with everybody else. And that being said, let's give the floor to our guest today, Yuquan Lin. It gives me great pleasure to have him speak here. Actually, he was scheduled to speak at PMF APAC this year. He has a super impressive experience. So Yuquan is a graduate of Stanford and has worked in all types of companies from startups. He founded his own startup at Y Combinator. He has worked for Google, for Microsoft. Currently, he's the head of product for buyer experience platform at Facebook. And most interesting of all, I have found out that he actually took 1 year of time to study jazz piano, which is his passion. So I'm really curious to hear what kind of courage took to actually stop working and do that. I think many of us are afraid to just, you know, leave their jobs and just dedicate it to a hobby. So I'm interested to hear how that went. And then he's going to share with us half an hour of his presentation, SaaS monetization lessons. And please ask questions. Yuquan Lin is a person who has over 15 years experience in products, so I'm sure that you can learn a lot from him. So don't be shy. Ask, even if it's not on topic, he's here to dedicate his time to you. So hopefully you will make the best out of it. Good. So that being said, Yuquan, the floor is yours. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Yeah, thank you very much, Lydia. And also thank you for the very kind intro there. I didn't know that actually you knew that I took some time off to play piano. So that was definitely a fun experience and probably maybe stories to share for another time. That said, really excited to meet everybody here. I think the talk I wanted to give for today, I wanted to share with all of you, was from my last role where I was head of product at Code Academy, where I helped them build up what we learned about building our business and how we learned in thinking about different business models. And then how do you build a product and a product team to really help the business grow? So I think as my experience is definitely not the right answer or the right way. I always think that there are many different ways to build products. And so for today, I think I'm really looking forward to just kind of sharing what I've learned along the way. And also I think there are a lot of amazing product managers in the crowd that I would love to hear from you guys and what you have learned as well. So with that, I'm going to try to project. You know, it's always a scary moment in these meetings where the moment where you have to project something. So let's see. All right, you guys all see it okay? Okay, wonderful. All right, going to, okay, so what I'm gonna share with you is kind of a distillation of the lessons and insights I learned at Code Academy, where I was head of product for about 2.5 years, from 2017 to basically the end of last year. And there you go. And then the context and the problem, before I start, I wanna also mention that in case you're not familiar, Code Academy is an online education company. We basically offer a lot of classes around programming, mostly technical education programming in different languages, JavaScript, HTML, so forth, to help you learn how to program online. And we're a big believer in the power of education to change lives. That was one of the reasons I joined the company, because I was also very excited. I've seen how it's changed my life personally and wanted to join a company whose mission is to democratize that and offer that to millions of people around the world. And what we found when I joined the company about 6 months in was that we were faced with a critical decision and a challenge. Is that at the time, the company had been around for probably 6 or 7 years and had always existed as a free product. And it was very popular. We had tens of millions of people around the world using it, which was great. And we had also raised a couple rounds of funding to continue to help the company grow. And that said, because we believe long-term to be sustainable, we really need to become a self-sustainable business rather than, say, like a charity that depends on gifts from other people, then it was very important that we build a robust business based on that. And so at this point, the company had experimented with two business models. One is an e-commerce business model, basically where you will buy a class like one at a time, and then a little bit like how you might like say purchase a movie from iTunes, and then you would just consume it and then be done with it. And then another model is a subscription model where it's much more say like a Spotify, where you would pay a monthly fee and you get access to all the courses you want. And we were testing both, where they both showed some positive signals, but also some challenges. And we weren't exactly sure how we were gonna decide and invest to move forward. And so this is the main problem that I'm gonna be sharing with you today. And so the way I think that we were, if we were really distilling it down, we were really facing a fork in the road, I think, into where, which direction we want to go. Do we want to become like an e-commerce business where there are some companies like this, like Udemy and so forth, that are very big in this space? Or do we want to become more like the subscription business about our education? And so today I'm going to take you through some of the insights, the analysis framework we did to figure out and then our decision, and then how we executed the decision and the outcome. So I'm going to kind of hop in a machine and go back really briefly into 2017. And so in 2017, this was the situation we were looking at. We wanted to grow the business. And for us, growing the business means that we want to generate higher revenue per user, which generally we just refer to as lifetime value. And we also wanted to grow the overall revenue so that the pie gets bigger over time. And on the surface, things were looking pretty good. We were doing both in the last like 6 months that I was on the job. So the lifetime value was growing, the overall revenue was growing. And this was because our e-commerce product has started to come online and had a much higher unit price, about $200 a class. And so we were pretty excited about that, and things seems to be going well. So, but unfortunately, as we dug into the data, what we found was that there were some troubling like future trends. So even though overall revenue was going up, when we started to break down the paid conversion rates by cohorts, what we started to notice was that the overall conversion rate was dropping by quite a lot. So the overall conversion rate is the yellow line at the top, which is composed of the green line, which is our subscription called Pro. That's conversion rate, as well as the e-commerce conversion rate, which is the blue line. So as I was saying, we have launched this e-commerce product and that seems to be growing and has a higher price point, and we're very happy and it seems that overall revenue is growing. But if we're looking at the conversion rates of the SaaS business was dropping a lot. And what this then pointed to, if you project this out into the future, is that, okay, how much money are we going to make in the future? And then that started to become more and more troubling. So if we broke things down by cohort, when we think about cohort is the groups of people that sign up from the same month. And we started to look at the revenue or LTV on a cohort basis. We actually see that overall, the predicted revenue for each cohort is like going down over time. And a lot of this, if you do the math backwards, basically is coming because the subscription business was being cannibalized much faster by the e-commerce business than the e-commerce business was able to make it up. And so this was definitely some troubling signs for us. So if we kind of summarize, and what we have observed is, although current revenue is growing, which is good, the projected future revenue looks like it's going to be slowing over time as the paying cohorts are declining. And then some of the reasons that insights that we are finding so far is that, well, the e-commerce business is great. It definitely raises the amount of revenue we can get from each user, but then it cannibalizes our subscription business, and it cannibalizes a lot. What is more is that also we find that a lot of these people, they'll buy one class and then they'll leave and then they don't really come back. So we end up in a bit of a churn and burn model where we go through users very fast, but there isn't a lot of returning value for us as a business or them as a user. And so there are some of these challenges. And as we look forward into 2018 at the time, there's definitely a lot on our minds. Like, we kind of think about, wow, even though things are looking pretty good now, there's definitely some dark clouds ahead in terms of revenues declining, our paying users are declining over time, what do we do next? And how do we grow this business? So what we did was we took an overall analysis framework, really anchored in lifetime value, which I think is a good way to capture both the business side and the user side of product management. I think as IPMs, we're often called to do both. You might be focusing on different aspects of advertising at different times. Sometimes you're very focused on the user problems you want to solve. Other times that you are trying to solve those user problems, but you're also trying to help grow the business. And I think this is a really good framework that actually balances the two very well and brings them all together. In the context of how we used it to analyze our business was, if you broke it down, what is the lifetime value of a user? There are actually, and fear value, I'll refer to the business value or the revenue value. There are three major components of this. Like the first one is around the, what I call the frequency of purchase, which is really around the probability that somebody is likely to purchase your product and then the number of times that they do it. And then times the amount of time that they spent on your site or in your product using this product, and then times the price that they're paying for it. And so if we tie this to the user problems, because I'm also a deep believer that I think to be great PMs, like first we focus on the user problems, is these are the important user problems that we want to solve well to be able to drive these different drivers of our lifetime value. So focusing on understanding the outcomes that the users want to achieve. And in our case, since we're educational, so what do they want to learn and what career outcomes may they want? Some people want a new job. Some people want to get promoted. Some people want to get new skills to do a project. This all factors into how, gives us insights into how we can increase their likelihood of purchasing our product. And then when they are using the product, then it becomes much more about, okay, when do you want to learn? How long do you want to learn for? And then what are the other complementary offerings that we can offer you so that you spend more time learning and you're really getting value from the learning. And if we're able to do both, which is that we're able to help you achieve the outcome you want and convince you that we can do that, and then we're also able to help you be successful when you're on site spending time with us, then we should be able to then figure out, okay, how much is it worth to you, and then price it accordingly. So diving in, I'll take you through the rest of my presentation, which is really anchored around this three-prong framework, which is around the how we think about, how we analyze and understand the decisions in the frequency of purchase and how we increase that, and then how we think about increasing time on site, and lastly, then how we think about price. And so the first thing that we had to do, which was really important, that we found to help our users understand, was to clearly differentiate our two product lines at the time. And to give you guys a little more context, what we have at the left is our SaaS business, which is really around an individual self-pay subscription product that you can sign up for and you can learn any classes you want. Again, think about this very much similar to like a Spotify, or if you say have used a MasterClass, for example, it's very similar to that. There's a bunch of classes you can take, you can learn from any of them, and you pick a fixed fee. And then on the e-commerce model is what we have are around these virtual group classes that you can pay one at a time. You sit in a group with a group of 80, 100 other people and you learn together. It's about 8 to 10 weeks. And in some way, some people think about that a little bit like a mini bootcamp. And what we found as we looked at, think about our product positioning was that for most people, the price point of a subscription and flexibility was what was really key. And that's accessible to many more people. And so what we decided in terms of positioning was to position the subscription as our entry point and a baseline. So it's like $20 a month, it's very cheap. We say like, hey, come try it out. It's not a lot of risk for you and see how you like it. If you're liking it, then there are definitely ways for us to upsell you into the group product later, which I can speak to later. There were also some advantages internally that we can make the content faster and so forth. But the key here is that we're really a big believer in lifetime learning. And so we believe that learning doesn't stop after a class, that you can really keep on learning forever. And so that's why we also believe that subscription is the right way to deliver this. And so now if we were to actually look at some of the hard data, what we did was an analysis of our paid conversion broken out by the different business models, subscription as well as the e-commerce product. And what we found was that in our particular case, a lot of the users that came to us were free and were using our free product, that they were converting very, very early. The ones that were paying were converting very early in their journey. So it wasn't like other products where you might use something free for many years and then eventually you convert. Like Evernote is a great example of this. So what we found in our product or in education, I think a lot of times is that the people that are willing to invest the time, our most valuable customers were the people that invested the time up front and then they got value out of it. And these people were the most likely to convert. And that's why so many converted up front. And that really led us to focus on the first month experience or the initial experience on the product side, thinking about everything about customized onboarding, beginner friendly curriculum, high touch engagement, all of these things to really focus on the initial experience. And that insight then also led us into thinking about how we were going to pivot our subscription product from which previously was a freemium product. So you could use Forever really for free and we would just upsell you along the way into a somewhat different model, which is what we were calling a trial model that you have seen again for a lot of products where it's a time-based trial. And rather than in a freemium product where you get access to all the basic use features for free, and then you have to really slowly accumulate over time to hit certain limits before you are prompted to pay, we decided that, well, since most of our paying users, they look like if they're gonna pay, they're gonna pay within the first month or two, then it does make sense then for us to shorten that time window and also have a fixed time window for them up front. Give them access to all the premium free features so that they know what they get if they pay, and then figure out the right paywall for it. And so this was one of our insights that we learned from a data analysis and also qualitative user research, is that a freemium model actually doesn't work for us so well, that it actually, in our case at least, that we were giving too much away in our freemium model. And that wasn't converting very well. And if we had shifted to a trial model, our hypothesis was that it's actually much better for the business and also for learners because they get access to all the premium features up front instead of being locked out that they have to unlock later. And just before I go into the next section, actually wanted to pause a bit. I know we have a lot of very experienced and talented PMs who are with us here today as well. Just wanted to ask all of you guys, if are there some effective ways that you have found to increase purchase frequency or conversion rate in your lines of work? And also put the question in chat, I believe. Yeah, Lily, I'm not very good with using the chat. Maybe you could help me put the question in chat.
No worries. I already put it in the chat.
Oh, okay. Wonderful. Yeah. Were there anybody that wanted to share anything? I can't quite see.
Right now, there are no answers, so I think.
Okay. No worries. Yeah. Then we'll keep going. Later. Yeah. No problem. Sorry, I'm having a little trouble with my slides. There we go. Try again. Okay, so this second component that I want to talk about then is what we learned about increasing the time of the usage time of the product because for us as educational product, it was really important, not just from a revenue perspective, but also just from a user value and serving user perspective, that, hey, we have to make sure that you're learning, you're enjoying learning. If you're not using our product and you're not enjoying learning, no matter what we do around monetization, you're going to leave at some point. And so we started to do a lot of work here to think about, okay, how do we increase the time that you're spending learning, make sure that's valuable? So what we then found out was that this is probably a very typical analysis you see in all SaaS businesses, is churn is one of the most key things you have to really monitor and get under control. And decreasing churn becomes very important for us for the subscription product. And so what we did was we looked at our past data, and then you can run this probability analysis that looks at the probability of churn based on your month of sign up. And what we found was that, oh, okay, our lifetime churn right now is not bad. We can definitely do this even better. That if you just look at this chart, if you use our product for about 4 or 5 months, there's like a 50% chance that we're going to keep you for a long time. And if you now really use it for 9 months and beyond, then the churn rate drops a ton to basically below like 10%. So that means like 9 out of 10 people were using the product. If they're able to use the product for more than 9 months, that they're really seeing a lot of value, and then they're very loyal, staying with us for like years. And that really provided a lot of insight into, okay, well, there are some key time markers. Let's think about then, is like, how do we get people to stay with us for more than 4 months to get over the first hurdle, and then like 9 months or basically like 10, 11 as like that next hurdle. And the curve is smooth. So it's, I know the hurdles are a little bit arbitrary, but it is a way for us to, as a product team, to then kind of really focus on, okay, how do we then move the needle and move the metric? And so I think as an educational company, one of the key things is what classes do we offer people to learn? And so 10xing or increasing our content and curriculum becomes like very, very key. And so in terms of scaling the content, there were a lot of things that we did. I won't go too much into detail here. Everything about improving the tools to figuring out a faster production model with some outsourcing and so forth that we looked into. But the basic goal was that we really wanted to increase both the depths of our courses that we offer, as well as the breadth, so that we can offer classes in many different domain areas. Like in the very beginning, we were very, very web dev focused, but then at the end of 2018, we were able to get to a good mix of data science and design, mobile, and so forth. And so going back, I think in terms of increasing time on site, the real key insight here was then how do we increase content and increase it fast and scalably, which then helps us reduce the churn that people are leaving the site. And coming to the last component, which is on price, is okay, now we figured out a way in which we can position the product, design it well, so that it convinces people this is worth paying for. And we also have a lot of classes that you can take for a long time once you are paying for it. Then that's great. If we're offering you this value, the next step then is think about, okay, what is then the right price to price this product at? And so what we've kind of dug into our research, and what we found was that there are different personas of users that we, and then there are different things for us to try so that we can position different product lines at different prices to be able to target them. So first of all, what we looked into was, okay, compared to competitors, for example, our prices were just like bargain basement low, and there were definitely room to raise prices. And I think you'll find that this a lot in other SaaS company products as well. You advise that if you're building a good product, don't be afraid to raise prices. Like prices is a signal as well as to quality, that if you have something you believe people are willing to pay for, like, go ahead and raise prices, and your customers will tell you. So this is an obvious lever, but one that we hadn't looked into. So we were going to invest in. And then in terms of tiering the prices or the products that we have, the second part is then in thinking about, okay, how do we want to position our mini classes to more be like boot camps? And these boot camps, and then if we were able to add the additional support, of course, as you know, that mini boot camps can run the gamut from $5,000 to $10,000, $15,000. And so our prices, even if it was only $1,000 or $2,000, is still much, much cheaper. And then there were a lot of high margin add-ons that we could provide with the mentorship and so forth. So in terms of the recap, what we found was that then, okay, so if we took a big step back, using our lifetime value framework, what we found was the e-commerce business model, it generated more revenue now because the price point was higher, but it really limited our long-term upside because the conversion rate, like people's willingness to buy these, were much, much lower. And they basically churned heavily, like 90-some percent churn. So basically bought it once, most people leave and never come back. And so this approach, if we were to really focus on the e-commerce part of our business model, would really limit our long-term upside in the business growth, which is why in the beginning, you started to see the projected revenue come down. And after doing all this research and analysis, what we found was, okay, if we went back and really invested in our subscription product, it actually has a much, much higher ceiling to grow. There's a bunch of things we can do here to really increase the amount of curriculum we offer, to offer all the premium features up front in a trial. So it's very convincing for people to see what we offer and then decide if they want to buy. And then like, we can raise prices, all of these things gives us a lot of hope that investing in the subscription product is actually the better way for us and how we want to grow long term. And so kind of tying all it back together into the framework, as I said, that is about how our strategy to increase the frequency of purchase is really around trial and pay one, focusing on the first month, scaling the curriculum, like I just mentioned, growing the community. And then lastly, once we've improved the product, it makes sense to raise prices. And then in terms of the long-term vision, how we tied it all together was, okay, if we look at learning, I think we're a big believer in that learning doesn't stop after school. That learning is a lifetime activity. And so how do we become a true lifetime learning partner for our students is really that we're going to offer you a very cheap subscription that you can just use and keep forever, just like how you might subscribe again to say like music or like Spotify or Netflix. And you can access to all these like classes. And every once in a while, when you have a big need, you're looking to switch jobs, you're looking to level up, complete a project. And that's where we can upsell you to our more intense learning product. And in this way, we wanted the analogy here we used was with Amazon, was that Amazon Prime offers you basically the subscription and access to like free shipping, which you get all the time, but then it also offers you the way to buy things individually. So how did it actually go? I think the one big thing that I'll kind of briefly touch upon here is that how we organize. I think building products always like comes down to people. And so I wanted to briefly talk about our organization and how we organize our teams to build out the strategy. And basically we staffed up a growth and monetization team that was really focused on how do we take our existing free courses and roll them into a subscription product, and then building out the paywall and the trial as I discovered. And then there's a team that really works on the discovery and the navigation of the entire site. How do you search for things? How do you make sure that they can get the classes that they're looking for? And then there's a team around the engagement and retention is, okay, now there are these learners who are actively learning, they're paying. How do we make sure that they're happy in their learning? And then there is, of course, the content production team that keeps making more content so that you never run out of things to learn. So you can also map this to the life cycle of a learner in that in the beginning, it is really about giving people exposure to our paid products and making sure that they understand that they're there. And then you look at how they discover all the courses and navigate the site while they're in the trial and finding what they want to learn. And then once they're converted, making sure that they're engaged and retained, and then making sure that they never run out of things to learn. So, and basically, we took like all of 2018 to execute this. So it was like a big initiative that took the whole company. I also reorganized the entire product team in the structure that I talked about before. And we started to launch experiments, started to get data back along the way. And a lot of our learnings, it became clear and clear as we got the data back that actually the e-commerce add-on model wasn't such a good model for us. So eventually we started to phase this out. And in 2019, then we shifted entirely to focus on our subscription business. So, and this is the last part, which I think people, a lot of people are often interested is, okay, well, that's great. You know, talked all about strategy, showed us all these pictures and numbers, great. Okay, what actually happened and how were the results? And I think here I want to show personally one of my favorite graphs in that I think a lot of working in startup or product in general, I think is really like this. You know, people think that, oh gosh, you know, I have this brilliant idea and you go and build it. And then overnight, tens of millions of people show up. And then 18 months later, we're bought for like $10 billion or something. In at least in my personal experience, that has not been the case. It's actually much, much more like this, where there's just like a lot of ups and downs over time. You're fighting a lot of very hard battles, and then there's a lot of unexpected challenges. And so if I show you now then our journey at a Code Academy, you'll notice that it's actually somewhat pretty similar, that it was not just like kind of a smooth curve all the way up. I had to redact some of the numbers. I hope everybody just understands for confidentiality reasons, but look at the trends of the charts. So this bookings is what we've referred to as like our paying users. And then the green line is the e-commerce product that we talked about. It was not entirely clear to us that the e-commerce product was not the right product. Like there were definitely times where it's like doing better. And the subscription product, had also had challenges where here we had like a big dip for a couple of different reasons. I think there were some internal reasons product wise. And then there were some external reasons in terms of we didn't quite do a good January like promotional season for New Year's learning and so forth. So overall, I would say that even though it was like upwards to the right, it was not always like a very smooth journey. But I think what we were really proud of in being able to grow the business was that at the same time that we were providing longer term value to users. And one of the key things we really look at is the percent of people that leave our product. And so basically when I first started at the company, the churn rate was like really quite high. It was in the high teens and maybe at points like even over 20% per month, which is really scary. That's almost like one out of every five people leaving. And then over time, as we did all the things I mentioned, adding the premium features, increasing the content, and then increasing the depth of our content and so forth, that we were able to really drive this down to a much lower point, basically to high single digits, I think by the time I left, which was like more than like a 2-time increase. And I think that really just shows that we are doing right by our users, we're delivering the value, and that's why they leave much less frequently. So, yeah, what's this? I think just some final kind of recap of some of my learnings when I was there was that I think what I call mix of business models. I think these are basically mixing business models. I mean, that a combination of say subscription and e-commerce, or say like advertising subscription and so forth. They're not always easy to pull off. And in our case, for a small company of at the time, it was about 30, 40 people in the beginning, like that was very, very hard. And trying to do both actually really, really hurt us because it created a lot of just internal confusion, tension, how do we design a product? Other things that I think I learned personally was that we took a long time to do a lot of this analysis that you can probably see is like fairly thorough. But in some cases, I think looking back, we probably could have moved a little bit faster. That we probably could have do the analysis, but still launch like small experiments along the way so that it could be done sooner. And then we can get the data back that informs us. And then also in framing this decision, in framing it as a two-way door, basically a decision that can be reversed as opposed to a more like, oh, this is very key. We can make this decision. We're not going to really change back later. I think that would have also helped me, could have helped us make the decision sooner. I think a lot of this, the learning really goes back into how do you help an organization and a team make important decisions relatively quickly so that the organization can learn and move forward. And I think long-term, that is really one of the key of the success of the team and the product is not always say the quality of one single decision, but the speed at which you can make those decisions and then how much you can learn from each decision. Is that speed of iteration that really helps a company and team differentiate long term. All right, yeah, with that, I think that will be at the end of my talk. Hopefully that still leaves us some time for questions. So yeah, I just want to open up the floor to see if there are any like questions from anybody or anything that people wanted to share.
Well, thank you so much, Yuquan. First of all, there's a couple of answers to your question.
So that's wonderful. Okay, yeah.
What are some effective ways to increase conversion rate or purchase frequency that you've discovered? And Patrick has answered something that's worked for me in the past is cross-selling another related product right before or right after the initial checkout.
Yeah, actually, Lulu, can we ask maybe one or two people to share? Like if Patrick is still with us or the other.
So Patrick, if you want, you can unmute yourself and hi.
Hi.
Hey, Patrick.
Hey, nice to meet you. Thanks for the really good talk.
Thank you.
The context here is I worked on an insurance product, and insurances are often related because if you need, there are certain categories of insurance products that people just need when they go through certain life changes. And so it's pretty natural to say, hey, if you have income now, that means you have more valuable things. And there are like probably a handful of insurance products that if you're buying one of them, you might also want to buy another. And so for us, like it was a simple experiment we ran where it's just like right after you buy one product, we ask if you want another one. And then people, like 20% of the people bought it. And so that was like a really quick win there to increase the frequency of purchases. If you count that as two purchases instead of one. Yeah.
Yeah, that's really smart. It definitely, we've found, we couldn't quite get it to work so well, but like cross-selling and bundling in like other friends' businesses, they've definitely found that to make a big difference as well.
I think Patrick, yeah. You had another question, right?
Oh, but there was another response to Yuquan's question. So do we want to, I can ask that question, but do we want to go through that one as well? Or?
Sure. Unfortunately, I think Michelle is no longer here, but her answer was offering software upgrades with new features, additional features, add-ons to the main software platform.
Yeah, I think those are really good insights as well. In our case, that's what some of what we found to work well, that we continue to add new features, and some of these were softer features, as you mentioned, that they could opt in into later. And we also found that to be a pretty nice mover for us. Did you mention you have a question, Patrick?
Yeah, I'm wondering how, because you talked about 10xing the catalog, and I think that's super cool. And you did self-service tools and everything, makes a lot of sense. And I was wondering how you balanced that speed with quality of the content, and whether quality was something that also affected churn in addition to like sheer volume of the content.
Yeah, that's a really great question. It was a really tough challenge for us. And I think if I was being honest, like even when I left the company maybe 2.5 years later, I don't think it was one that we had completely solved, because at the highest level, like you said, sort of volume and quantity and quality are somewhat like inversely correlated. Like what we found was like there was no one silver bullet. There was just like a bunch of small things that we had to try. Some of it is somewhat special to education, but maybe some of it can be generalized to other industries as well. Like what we found was initially we tried an approach where we would say take an entire course and we will outsource that. And of course, like what we found was the quality coming back is it's all over the place. Like some people are really great, some people were not. Or they don't exactly know what we were looking for, like what is the Code Academy like quality bar. And then over time, we started to move a bit to like a hybrid model where we would say have like a curriculum, we call like a curriculum designer, a little bit like a lead-ish type of person or an architect, if you will, think in the software context, which is like they might write like the outline or the syllabus of, say, a course, like, oh, these are the things you want to teach. And here's like a handbook on what it means to like meet a quality bar. And then we could then like farm out like some of the production of the actual say exercises and lessons to outside vendors or freelancers that we found. That helped a bit, that helped partially, but it wasn't a perfect answer. And so additional things that we found was the sourcing of the production was really important. Like we actually found freelancers to be much better for us as opposed to say vendors or companies, because usually freelancers are like very passionate. Like the reason they're freelancing to make education was because they really love it in the first place. And so sort of being really careful on the hiring that then helped a bit. And then lastly was on the quality assurance and the checking process. We developed a fairly sophisticated way of double checking the content where have like separate groups for, there are people who author, and then there are people who sort of specializes in like testing and checking. And then they will also go through a double pass. And then you would do like random samples of, because there was too much content for somebody to like go through everything, but then how sort of we set up like random samples to get a baseline of what the quality looked like. And then we also, the curriculum designer gets involved to look at the really key pieces, the intros, the again, syllabi, the framework that helped as well. So no one silver bullet, I guess. And I think for a lot of content companies, it's a challenge that you just kind of continue to have to work on.
Yeah, makes sense. Thank you.
Yeah. Was that something you or your company deals with right now? Just curious.
I am no longer working for the insurance company, but I'm working on my own idea, and there are certain educational components of my idea as well, and also like SaaS components as well. So I'm pretty interested in what you just said. So thank you for doing this.
Yeah, no worries. Yeah, I'm happy to chat more offline too if you are all interested.
Cool. Yeah, I'll definitely hit you up on LinkedIn.
Cool. Yeah. Do we have other questions?
Not for the moment. Everyone, if there's any other question, I think now is the time to ask it. I think otherwise feel free to reach to Yukwan as well on LinkedIn. I'm sure he will be more than eager to answer you. We have another question from Daniel. What are your tips? And Daniel, if you want to unmute yourself and ask it live, please do. What are your tips for B2B SaaS pricing?
Hi, thanks a lot for the talk. Really interesting. I'm currently in a B2B company, but it was really cool to hear experience from a B2C environment, and I think it's very, very helpful, like the way you broke it down. I thought I'll just ask you, if you have some time left, also about your tips of B2B pricing. I believe that's something you might have been doing in Facebook. And it's less of a sort of a subscription here. Where I'm coming from is that we are an AI insights company. We generate insights from big data sets and we sell them to lenders or to consumer internet platforms to fight fraud. And so I was just wondering if you have any tips on pricing really, and how do you really gain the pricing power in terms of differentiation? Because what we are seeing is that a lot of B2B products are getting commoditized to some extent. So what are some of the right frameworks of thinking how to differentiate so that you can either maintain your pricing or charge more, or you know, how much you sort of drop the price in case you're less differentiated?
Yeah, great question. And thanks for sharing also the context, Daniel. It's a really interesting problem. Can I just ask a little more about like what is the nature of your product? For example, do you sell software or is it, do you sell like say insights via report or dashboard or that might help maybe help me understand a little more.
Insights, a typical product that would be a credit score.
A credit score.
Various big data sources to generate a credit score about the user. Mm-hmm. And then we sell that to banks to have them in underwriting. A couple other like affluence score or fraud score, a probability that the client is going to commit fraud.
I see. Got it. Okay.
But anyway, just sort of sharing context from my perspective, right? I think you can sort of zoom out of that a little bit, and if you want to share some more generic from your experience, that would for sure be helpful as well.
Yeah. Some of my lessons are a little more consumer focused. That said, I think in my past life, I had also worked in ad tech, which was much more B2B focused. And so there, I think some lessons might apply as well. I think in terms of just general lessons that we found with pricing was that experimentation is really pretty key. And I know it's a little easier to do that on consumer because you can just run these A/B tests on pricing and you can get data back and you can react relatively quickly. And I know on enterprise, it's a lot harder. It's not like you can have all these different price variants that you run with your customers in a form of A/B tests. But that I wonder though, then I imagine your sales are with like pretty big enterprise customers. And if that was the case, then I wonder if there is room though to maybe position each deal somewhat separately to test out different price points and see their reactions to that. I don't know if that's how you do sales today, or is it like a standard price, you have a web page and you just throw people over there to put them to decide.
There is hope for that for sure, yeah. Because it's also a volume game, right? Like if you sell fewer, then you might charge more, but you sell less. If you make it cheaper, you might sell a lot more. The lower unit cost, but overall increase your revenues.
Exactly, yeah. And other things that I've seen work well that we were starting to do, but maybe have not done 100% of, is in starting to think about pricing more from the perspective of what is it worth to the consumer or the buyer. And this in the enterprise space might require a fair amount of research and talking with the clients, but I don't know if you guys have done some research into what are the alternatives that they're using today or what problems that your systems or product can really help them solve, and what is that pain point or that what is the value of solving that problem to them? For example, maybe it's like the estimated damage of cost. Maybe it's in tens of billions or something. I'm not sure. And I'm just like curious if that's an angle you guys have looked at.
Yeah. No, that's something we look at as well. Yeah. And then we sort of, you know, we're what we're debating right now is what is the right ratio between the price and the value you create.
Mm. Interesting. Can you tell us a little more about that, like what you mean by the value, price and value?
So like if you buy the product for X dollars, how many dollars is it going to make for you? So an example is that if you, let's say, sell an insight for a dollar and it might save you $10, then you're creating 10x value to your price.
Yeah.
So you know, one of the questions, so it's always interesting, sort of what's that 10x, is it 5x? How should you sort of price it from that perspective?
Yeah. That's a great way of packaging it, I think, or framing it, like you said, is for every dollar you put into your product and what they might get in return on value on the buyer side.
I think
all these seems like quite promising directions. So good luck to you guys. And I hope your experiments go well.
Thanks again. Thanks again for the talk.
Yeah, thank you, Daniel.
Yeah, I can have a quick follow-up question to your talk specifically. I see there
are
other questions coming up. When you were structuring your product team, so there was a table that you showed on one of the slides.
Yeah.
What was your rationale for drawing up the boundaries between who does what? And I saw that you define it from a sort of a mission objectives perspective rather than who takes care of what part of the website, right? Or what part of the product. So, and I like that, right? But at the same time, how did you ensure that every part of the product gets looked after? And how did you decide what actually happens? Because maybe two different teams want to work on the same end feature. And then how do you reconcile what that end feature is going to look like?
Yeah, I think there's no perfect way to draw org charts in general. And so what I found that I prefer over time in terms of defining it by mission and objectives is that I think it helps to at least help the team to be a little more focused back on the mission and the user. Like what I've seen in a lot of teams is that inevitably, I think it's human nature that every team sort of wants their ownership to grow. And so if starting out a little bit too much on the just like, oh, this part of the website is for this team and that part of the website is for that team, sometimes can get people maybe a little bit too much in that mindset of, okay, what do I own or what does my team own versus the other team? And bringing it back to the mission and saying that, hey, the discovery and navigation team, your job is really to help users like find what they're looking for and sometimes recommending things if they don't know what they're looking for and trying to really like focus on that, solving that problem. And that kind of, I think, helps my team to feel like they're working together as a team. And then, for example, the growth team is really focused on, oh, okay, people have found what they want to learn. Okay, great. Your job is to now really fully convey that value of what we offer so that they'll be willing to pay for it. From a team cohesion perspective, I find that to be helpful. In terms of practicality or how it actually executes, like, yes, I do then talk, it's not in this table, but we do outline like, oh, these are like the areas of say the product or the app or the website that each team owns. And then I try to make sure that there is not too much overlap between the teams. Inevitably, there are some where there's some overlap where the teams will have to collaborate together. And that's just an ongoing process where I sit down with the team and we figure out, okay, how are we going to work on this? Which team is going to do what? And sometimes when we find that there are constantly overlaps or friction, then sometimes it is a time to look at the org chart again and think about, oh, maybe it's time to change the org design somewhat. I don't think an org design is also a permanent thing. I think it needs to evolve to fit the team and the business at the time. So it's something that we continuously evolved. Even in the 2.5 years I was there, I changed it probably a couple times.
Thanks a lot. I really like the approach.
Yeah. Thanks, Daniel.
Cool. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Yuquan, for your time and patience in answering all the questions. It was a super interesting presentation. We'll probably share the video after or parts of it. And yes, feel free to reach out to Yuquan if you have more questions. I think he has great insights. And otherwise, we see each other next Monday. We have the next PMF Connect, so it's not going to be on Tuesday. It's going to be on Monday, where we're going to share Anu AJ from Sentry, Anupam Jindal. He's going to share about the essentials of driving exponential growth. Yuquan, if you want to say goodbye to everyone, now it's the time before we close.
Yeah, so thank you all for coming and spending an hour with me. Really enjoyed it. Enjoyed hearing from everybody and your questions. And yeah, I hope we stay in touch and we all continue to grow together. So thank you again. And thank you, Lulia and PMF, for organizing this wonderful event.
Thank you, sir. Bye, everyone.
Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you.